All right, it's time for another beer, rum, and rock and roll rock shot. This time we're celebrating the 50th anniversary of the Rolling Stones' 11th studio album, Sticky Fingers. How are you, man? Are you ready to talk about this classic album?
I'm a little off today, Randy.
Are you?
The show is now beer, scotch, and rock and roll rock shot because I forgot to put Coke in the fridge. And I like my rum and cokes for the show. So now I got the scotchy scotch. So cheers to you. And cheers to the Stones on their 50th for this record. And let's get at it, brother.
Mm-hmm. You're going all Ron Burgundy style. I'm not man enough for scotch. I'll tell you that right now. Okay, man. I got to run down some stats and shit. And then we'll talk about what we think of this album. Go track by track. Cool.
Sounds great, man. Yep. Perfect.
All right. So it was over 500 days in the making. And it eventually... they recorded it in 3 days before the release of their previous album, Let It Bleed. Now, I know that sounds convoluted, but there was a gap of time there, about 17 months, where the Stones camp was just a shit show. Like, there was that tragedy at Altamont, they're renegotiating record deals, they got financial issues, they got touring issues. It was just a mess professionally and personally, like a lot of drugs, of course, going on and that kind of shit. But it was finally released on April 23rd, 1971, on their very own record label, Rolling Stones Records, which brought about the famous logo that's on your t-shirt and mine.
Yeah.
The lips and the tongue take off on Mick, no doubt. And it became the most famous logo in music history. No big deal, right?
No big deal. It's such a great one though, man.
It was also the band's first album to reach number one in the UK and the US album charts. So that's cool. Produced by Jimmy Miller, who produced a bunch of their early shit, Beggar's Banquet, Let It Bleed, Exile, Goat's Head Soup. Performing on the album were, of course, Mick Jagger on lead vocals, Keith Richards on electric and acoustic guitar, Mick Taylor on electric guitar, Bill Wyman on bass guitar, and Charlie Watts on the drums. But you also had some additional players, like Ry Cooter plays slide on a track, Bobby Keys plays sax on a few, as usual, and Billy Preston plays organ on a couple, and Ian Stewart plays piano on a couple. It's the usual crew from that time period, right?
These guys were a part of the family. They were Rolling Stones. Yeah, for sure.
Absolutely.
Mick was the biggest change for this band. You'll notice on this record. You'll notice.
Yeah. He's almost too good for the Stones. You know?
Oh, yeah.
Basically, it's his debut album with the Stones. He played on a couple tracks on Let It Bleed, but this is his first real album.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about the album cover by Andy Warhol. I mean, it's so iconic. It's a picture of a guy's crotch in tight-fitting jeans.
It's right there.
It actually had a working, and it actually had a working zipper at one point.
Oh, yeah. That was quickly stopped after it was ruining all the records, the vinyl inside the packaging. Right. But what a cool way to introduce the record with something as so different and outlandish as that was. It worked, and there was even something tucked in there, kind of a poor man's underwear or something. I don't know what I never had the actual one, but I heard this. Right. Yeah.
Some tighty whiteys were in there at one point. Yeah.
Pretty cool. Yeah.
Yeah. It was super expensive to make too, is the other thing.
Sure.
So they eventually scrapped it and just went with the photo because people were bitching about it.
Yeah. Speaking of that, that artwork and that photo. Yeah. It's still unclear who the model was for the album cover. A lot of people thought it was Mick, but he clearly states it's not. And I heard he swings to the left and the image is clearly to the right. So he's out. But yeah, that's kind of an interesting thing too, is that we don't really know, but yeah.
Right. Yeah. Mick's a lefty. apparently he took shots of a bunch of dudes. So nobody knows who it is. He won't say .
Right. According to Keith, Mick isn't that well endowed, apparently. So
right, it's right in his book.
In his book. So there's that. You know what I mean?
Oh, dude. Can you imagine somebody writing that about you? Holy fuck.
It'll never happen, Randy.
Yeah, it never happened to me.
No way.
Okay, man, before we get into the specific tracks, what did you think of the overall album?
Well, with Mick Taylor's playing sonically and musically, it just amped the level up to a completely different level for me. And being a guitar player, that's welcome, really. I mean, Keith had all the vibe and the thing, but this guy's now a player. I mean, you watch him live, it's like he's so into what he's doing. There's nothing else going on. He's just that dedicated to the craft. You know, that's the one big standout on this record. The other is that it's chock-a-block full of different awesome songs. There's people that this is the quintessential best ever Rolling Stones record that will ever be, pointing at Randy.
Yeah, that'd be me.
Yeah. And that says something right there, is how big of a record this was at that time and how it still stands up today as the Stones record. You know, I'm an Exile guy, but musically, sonically, songwriting, everything on this record and pushing some boundaries for sure, as we'll get into on some of these tracks. It's a fucking amazing record. Yeah,
it really is. Yeah, for me, yeah, it's my number one in the Stones catalog for sure. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love Exile too, but just it's sticky by a nose, you know. Mm-hmm. For me, it just captures everything the Stones do best, man. That bluesy swagger, the cool riffs, and the attitude out the ass. Like, the attitude on this album is just awesome. It's the first album of my favorite period of the Stones, like that Sticky Fingers, Exile, Goat's Head Soup, It's Only Rock and Roll. Those four albums are just untouchable, man. And yeah, I love Ronnie Wood, but musically, those Mick Taylor Stones albums, they're just amazing. You know, I mean, Ronnie's a better fit overall, perhaps, you know, from a live perspective, he's awesome on the stage, but musically, those four albums kick ass. Those four albums are just fucking deadly.
You can't hang too much on Ronnie because he's an incredible player too, and he does a lot of heavy lifting for the Stones. But you're right, man. That era with Mick sounded amazing. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. Okay, man, let's get to the music. All tracks written by Mick Jagger and Keith Richards, except for two, and we'll point those out as we go. Opener, Brown Sugar. I can name that song in one note. Of course, it's a fucking classic. It's played at every Stone show. The groove is amazing. The riff is amazing from Keith. And lyrically, Jagger is at his most provocative, man. I can't think of another song that's more edgy. Touches on slavery and rape and oral sex and drugs and you name it.
Woo.
Yes, which is not bad. Yeah. you'd never get away with these lyrics today. And Mick would never write this song today, but it's a product of the times, man. What can you say? So let me give you a little taste. When you read it, it's so much worse than when you hear it in the actual song. Gold Coast slave ship bound for cotton fields, sold in a market down in New Orleans. Scarred old slaver knows he's doing all right. Hear him whip the women just around midnight. Brown sugar, how can he taste so good? Brown sugar, just like a black girl should. But my theory is with this, yes, it's of the time, and perhaps that's no excuse, but it gets so ingrained in the culture and it's on the radio so much and everybody knows it and hears it and hears it. You just filter that shit out. Like, you're not really hanging on every word Mick Jagger's saying. It's just, it's a vibe of the song and that's where it ends. Like, even he's quoted as saying, God knows what I'm on about in that song. It's such a mishmash. All the nasty subjects in one go. I never would write that song now. That's what he says. And live, he switches the lyrics to compensate that, and he can do that, and off you go. It's all good.
But I honestly believe that most people don't pay as much attention to the lyrics of songs like that. They remember Brown Sugar, and they're thinking it's a positive, I like black women song kind of thing.
Right.
You know,
what's the problem?
Yeah. Right, that's right. And they don't get into the minutiae of what Mick might be singing about there. But yeah, it's a tough one. And obviously, yeah, he's changing the lyrics now because he doesn't feel comfortable singing that stuff, but the song is fucking killer. The groove is killer. The musicianship is killer. That hook off the top, it's all Keith as one knows, clearly it's awesome. It is such a great song.
Number two is Sway. So this is a slow blues track, solid tune. The Mick Taylor outro solo is wicked. Keith doesn't even play guitar on this one, which is crazy, but he was missing in action. He's MIA, Keith, at this point. Where's Keith? Well, he's gone, so they just continue, and Mick plays rhythm guitar in it. First time he's played guitar on a song. And I just love the fact that it's different than Brown Sugar. They're changing it up right away, and that's cool. and it's a good blues tune.
The song had a live off the floor feel to me. It wasn't a crafted song. It felt like it was just kind of happened serendipitously. This is the vibe I got from the track. And here, yeah, the Mick Taylor shredding was, this is the new Stones, right?
Yeah.
And it was clear on this track for me right away, you know. And I love hearing Mick and Keith sing. Even though Keith didn't play on it, I could tell he's singing on it. And right. In the chorus, you undeniable, and they sound so great together. Perfect. Yeah.
I agree 100%. Yeah. They do sound great together.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of sounding great together, number three, another fucking classic, Wild Horses. It's a perfect example of what Mick and Keith can accomplish together. I mean, this song is just amazing. Keith's got that riff and chorus line, and Mick comes in with the verses, and it's just, it meshes beautifully, man. This song is just amazing. It's a classic for a reason.
Yeah, and stays acoustic, which is a nice way to hear them. Intimate, recorded at Muscle Shoals, like Brown Sugar was. It's got this kind of edginess to it that really stands out harmonically. It's nice to listen to, you know, with right. that edginess to it. But this is a top tenor Stones tunes, you know, on this record. Well, there's a few
for
of them.
Sure.
There's a number of them on this record. Let's not kid ourselves.
It's like a greatest hits album. Yeah.
Yeah, it pretty much. There's a lot of it in here, but this is a beautiful song. A beautiful song. Yeah.
It really is. Okay. Number four, Can You Hear Me Knocking? This would be my second favorite song on the album. Clocking in at over 7 minutes. It was a bit unusual for the Stones. It's got that open G riff from Keith off the top. Just the groove on this riff is just amazing. And what's really cool is at about 3:40, it turns into this instrumental jam thing with Bobby Keys killing it on sax, Billy Preston on the organ, and Mick Taylor again with this killer outro solo. It's super tasty. And what is fucking bananas about this, from what I read, they didn't even know the tape was running. They're just fucking, hey, let's just keep playing and see what happens. Well, that's what's on the album. It's one take. They don't know the tape's rolling, and that's how good these fucking guys are.
Yeah, in the moment, sometimes, well, most of the time wins, right? What struck me about this song was the interplay between the lyrical melody and the music and the words, can you hear me knocking? Can you hear me knocking? It's like knocking on the door. It's
yes.
You know, this kind of flavor was, it just works so well together. And it's earworm, love the track just on that level, let alone the fact they got the big jam out and all that. But it's so loose and swagger like Keith likes to play, and it's all there and it's all good.
Wow. Well put. It's all there and it's all good.
Is it ever?
It really is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, number five, You Gotta Move. So this is a traditional blues cover, so one that Mick and Keith did not write, but it suits them to a fucking T. I love when the Stones go full blues like this, and Mick Taylor, again, just shines on slide. It's just a great blues song, and they just nail it. I love it.
Yeah, this was super rootsy mix, going back to that early blues stuff where it's not slick at all. It's rough. Charlie Watts has stood out on this song for me with the simplicity of his, just a kick drum and a hat that the hi-hat is played and mixed so loud. It's like a crack, and it's nasty and rough around the edges, but it worked perfectly with how rough that this was mixed to kind of get that aesthetic of that old blues that they obviously grew up on, loved, and wanted to pay some homage to on this record. So good on them. Sounded great. Works nicely in there with everything we've heard so far, you know.
Again, there's just this yin and yang every track, man. And this is no exception. Number six, Biatch. Bitch. This is my favorite song by the Stones of all time. There's something about this song. There's something about the riff. There's something about the groove. It mixed vocal. It's just got tons of swagger and badassery, to use one of your words.
Yeah.
I love it. And I love the horns. The horn stabs over that main guitar riff are so cool. I just love it. Can I oversell that anymore?
You don't need to, because I know that there's a lot more of you out there, including myself, that absolutely love this track for a number of reasons. For me, it's a go-to when I pick up a guitar. It seems like every guitar I pick up, I want to do you know, I just got to play it. And you know, Keith's got these little flares, you know, it's just, it's these little moments that Keith brings to this track and the swagger of it. The title alone is awesome. You know,
can I give you some lyrics?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mick is on fire here, man. Oh dude. Yeah. Sometimes I'm sexy, move like a stud, like kicking the stall all night. Yeah. When you call my name, I salivate like Pavlov's dog. Yeah. When you lay me out, my heart is pumping louder than a big bass drum. All right. And guaranteed he's kicked a lot of stalls in his fucking day. And it's just, it's so Mick Jagger and it's just so cool.
It is. It is. And like you said about the horns, Keith has always talked about how he grew up listening to a lot of music and loved brass and horn sections and wanted to incorporate that style into the music they play. And obviously they got a great horn section, but it's just the tasty moments that they play are just so musical and so the Stones. And as we know later, a decade later, the sax became the worst instrument you wanted to hear in pop music or rock music or whatever, but they were doing it right from the get-go. And it was fantastic.
Are you talking about Kenny G?
Is that I'm talking St. Elmo's Fire to Kenny G to Lost Boys soundtrack. You know what I mean? It just all went wrong, right?
It can be done right.
It can be, you know what I mean? And they show this a few times on this record with a great horn section. Awesome song. Awesome song. 100%.
Yeah, Bobby Keys is a fucking beast. There's a documentary on him on Amazon Prime too, if anybody's interested. It's a bit low budge, but he's cool. I have a quote from engineer Andy Johns on this Keith Richards riff and how that happened. Keith was very late. Shocker. So Jagger and Mick Taylor had been playing the song without him, and it didn't sound very good. I walked out of the kitchen, and he was sitting on the floor with no shoes, eating a bowl of cereal. Suddenly he said, "Andy, give me that guitar." I handed him his clear Dan Armstrong plexiglass guitar and he put it on, kicked the song up in tempo and just put the vibe right on it. Instantly, it went from being a mess into a real groove. And I thought, wow, that's what this guy does. Keith put the stank on it, man. Like, how awesome is that?
And surprisingly, it's probably not a whole lot. You know, it's like degrees, but those degrees make a huge difference. Like you said, you know, is a change in tempo and just a bit of a feel. The notes were all there.
Yeah.
They were playing the song like the song was crafted. It's just that little minutia that Keith brings, like you say. And Mick, yeah, he benefits from that big time, because I think that Mick's performances feed off of that. Anybody else in Mick's camp is not going to help him like Keith does. 100%.
No doubt. Yeah, they're great together for sure. Okay, number 7, I Got the Blues. So we're slowing things down again. Another slow blues number. They shine again on this kind of stuff. It's who the Stones are at the core, right? And this one, you know, there's a bit more of a gospel vibe to it. And I like the cool organ solo from Billy Preston. And I also like the way it slowly builds, right? It builds up towards the end, and it's fucking badass.
Yeah, the organ solo really jumped out. I mean, they mixed it hot. They obviously appreciated his performance on this track, as should. And it just doesn't get just tucked in there. It's like featured heavily. Yeah, and they took it down a notch. Again, this wonderful arc in music and tempo and pace, and stylistically a little bit different again, you know. Awesome. Awesome track. And where it should be on the record, in my opinion.
I love this track order. It's great.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Just one thing that is popping into my head with Billy Preston, that dude's afro was awesome. Yeah. Like, it was so awesome, dude.
I miss seeing the pics coming out of those type of things in those days, you know?
That dude was rocking the fro, man. Okay, number 8, Sister Morphine. So this is another co-write. We got Marianne Faithful on this one. It's a slow one again, but about halfway through, it picks up. And Ry Cooter plays slide on it, which is very cool. So again, I don't know what to say other than I like it, obviously. It's a great song. And again, it's just something different.
The opening of the track, Mick sounded very frail, kind of weak, you know, which is interesting because, you know, he usually comes off larger than life and kind of there. And as it to this day at nearing 80, you know, it's crazy. But it was a nice change of tone. And yeah, the slide thing, it jumps out at you and plays a role in this song. And it's a Stone song that still feels like the Stones, even though it's got a different layer that you're not generally used to hearing, right? It's cool.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
It's cool.
Okay, speaking of mixing it up, number 9, Dead Flowers. I mean, I dig it. It's their fun country tinge track. It's got some dark lyrics. I mean, the basic gist of this is Keith is hanging with Graham Parsons a lot. They're drug buddies, and he loves what Graham Parsons does musically. So this influenced this song for sure. I mean, lyrically, it's kind of, I mean, it's hilarious, right? And you could send me dead flowers every morning, send me dead flowers by the mail, send me dead flowers to my wedding, and don't forget to put roses on my grave.
Oh, see, I mean, the Stones go after a genre.
Yeah.
But they don't try to be traditional with it like Graham Parsons was. And the guys in that ilk that Keith was hanging out with, they were very country guys. But they give this tongue-in-cheek, and they continue to do so. I mean, this song is great. It's awesome. You know,
yeah.
I mean, I have my favorite country and Western song by the Stones.
I know where you're going.
You know what song that might be? But they weren't afraid to do it again, which is awesome. And that gave it even more merit of why they took it on. And it's a fun track. It is.
You're talking about Faraway Eyes of Some Girls, of course.
That's right. Of course I am.
Actually, it's better, I think.
I do too. I think they were getting there, you know. This was the first taste. And it's fun. It's fun. It's what it's supposed to be.
Well, they clearly just do what they do. They're not restricted by any kind of genre. They just do what they do. Yeah. That's awesome. Last but not least, number 10, Moonlight Mile. Closing track. It's a ballad, but it's got a different vibe to it. So Jagger and Mick Taylor were working on it without Keith. Keith is, again, missing in action.
Eating cereal somewhere on the floor.
Exactly. Where's Keith? So Mick Taylor and Mick Jagger are working on this song together. And they're working it out. And it's Mick Taylor's idea to put strings on it, blah, blah, blah. But he gets a little choked that he does not get a writing credit on it. And I never really understand that. But whatever. It's not like he quit the band over it, but he was a bit choked. Lyrically, it's about being on the road. So Jagger's quote is, "The feeling I had at that moment was how difficult it was to be touring and how I wasn't looking forward to going out and doing it again. It's a very lonely thing." And my lyrics reflected that. So I thought that was funny to read considering how many years they kept touring.
Yeah,
it can't totally be that bad. But yeah.
I thought it was a great song to end the record with. You know, it's not something that I've listened to this song 100,000 times. It's not one of those kind of tracks, but it has an interesting arrangement. It was kind of different for the Stones for sure. Soft, but with conviction is what I kind of wrote down. The only thing that stuck out on this song for me was the strings. And I just felt like, you know, the song didn't need it, and it felt like it was kind of Beatlesque almost. And when those things kind of happen, I'm going, why are you going there? The question is for every human on the planet, Beatles or the Stones, right? I know what category I fall in, and this didn't need to go down that road. But again, it was a nice track. And I mean, the whole record is incredible. Like it just is. It's a great fucking record. And you should listen to it front to back.
But you're right. I mean, this album is just a fucking great mix of what the Stones do best.
Yeah.
Rockers, blues songs, country songs, ballads. It's got a bit of everything.
Yeah.
So that's why it's Desert Island for me for a Stones album, because it's got a bit of everything.
Yeah.
And I love it, man.
Yeah.
What can I say?
It's all good right there, brother. And, you know, 50-year celebration of this record, and still sounds great. I urge everybody to go out there and listen to it top to tail.
Well, speaking of top to tail, if you want to see them do it top to tail, this release from the Stones Vault It's them at the Honda Theater in Hollywood, 2015. They do Sticky Fingers in its entirety. Yeah, it's awesome. So you get the Blu-ray of the show and you get a CD. So a couple of things of note, they start with Start Me Up because they want to come out all guns fucking blazing, right?
Yeah, sure.
And then they get into the album, but they change the running order because, like, to quote Mick, well, I'm not doing Brown Sugar first. I'm ending with that. Right. I'm closing with Brown Sugar. That's that.
Yeah.
Which I get. So they mess around with the running order, but all the tracks are there. And then the encore is Rock Me Baby, their tribute to B.B. King, and Jumpin' Jack Flash.
Great.
What else can I say? I think that's it. That's all.
Go listen to this record and get your fingers sticky, kids. Yeah. Let's go.
Yeah. Keep your hands where I can see them. Feel free to leave your comments below. Tell us what you think of this album, how it impacted you, what you like, what you don't like. Follow us on all the socials. Don't forget to hit subscribe. And until next time. Keep rock alive, motherfuckers. Peace.
Rock on.